governor finish his press conference and informational session, in case there was anything else that we needed to know before we came out here. And there was, of course, some information that he did come up with. I want to thank everyone for being here today as we go through the latest with regards to the coronavirus and COVID-19 illness that is, of course, a global pandemic as determined by the World Health Organization. We're joined here by a number of representatives from various Erie County departments. Of course, our Commissioner of Health, Dr. Gail Burstein, our Commissioner of the Department of Homeland Security Emergency Services, Dan Nevitz Jr., who's also joined by the Deputy Commissioner, Greg Butcher. We are also joined by Scott Petronic from the Erie County Sheriff's Office, and I thank Kendra from Deaf Access Services for being here today to offer American Sign Language to those who are maybe hearing impaired. So as a reminder, the information that we're presenting right now is the latest information and the most current, at least at the time the presentation was made. The situation is rapidly evolving, and for the latest numbers and guidance with regards to the Department of Health, we always recommend going to our COVID-19 page, which has been active for some time now, and we do update as appropriate. We are going to do a little presentation, and then, of course, we'll take some questions and answers afterwards. I'll let Doc talk about this, that for those of you who don't know, the coronavirus is one of multiple coronaviruses. So, Doc?
Right. So, the coronavirus has a big family. There are many different strains. And we've all been infected probably with one strain of the coronavirus because it's responsible for – some of the strains are responsible for the common cold that we all get every year. However, it can mutate and cause some pretty scary disease. We know that the SARS was a coronavirus, and the MERS was a coronavirus. And now this new strain, this novel coronavirus, COVID-19 that we're calling it, is also a coronavirus. What's scary about this is that it's very, very contagious. The reproductive rate is the R-naught is 2. So that means without any intervention, for one person who is infected, they will infect 2 people.
Thank you. We were able to update it with the latest from New York State, which is 328. They're still on the 127,863 cases as identified by Johns Hopkins University on the map of the world, but we know that is not an accurate number because that is a number from earlier today that has not been updated. And earlier it was 1,323 for the United States. That probably has grown because that did not include the New York numbers or some of the most recent ones. We'll note the United States numbers, at least from the 1,323, that was a 50% growth plus since, or actually it's been a doubling. It was 573, so it's really 100% growth since just the 9th. So in 3 days we've seen a doubling of the cases in the United States. As the doc was saying, the reproduction rate of this is about 2.2. I'll let her talk a little bit more about some of this stuff.
So it's we know it's very, very contagious. Fortunately, the good news is that most people will not become symptomatic. It's about 80% of the pace of people do not have symptoms. However, there is a significant proportion, about 15 to 20%, that do develop severe symptoms, and that's not across the board. That's mostly our elderly, and like people 60 and up, and people with other healthcare conditions, and smokers. So those are people at high risk. Also, the case fatality rate is estimated to be between anywhere between 2 and 3%. We know that we don't have good figures of our case fatality rates right now in the United States because, fortunately, we haven't had that much experience with it. But hopefully, overall, as the year progresses, we'll have more data and we'll be able to make more accurate calculations for our case fatality rate in the United States.
The confirmed case rate confirmed, that's the number 127 and 4,718, is 3.6%. But as noted, there probably are many more cases. We don't know the exact fatality rate other than the confirmed cases of coronavirus versus the confirmed deaths from coronavirus, and that is 3.6% worldwide. However, as the doc noted, the vast majority of individuals who will actually get the coronavirus probably will have, at worst, mild symptoms. Or just feel like they have a cold. The problem is individuals over the age of 60 are much more at risk, especially over the age of 70, where it's much more a fatal rate. So we don't really know the exact fatality rate right now, but if you do the strict extrapolation of the confirmed cases versus confirmed deaths, it's a little less than 4%. Containment strategies, you've heard a lot about these, and of course the president talked much more about them yesterday. Travel restrictions have been in place. Airport entry screening of travelers from China directly. There is, of course, the identification and monitoring of high and medium risk individuals. There's lab testing of symptomatic individuals. Lots of containment strategies, and we'll go into the latest travel restrictions and recommendations. China, Iran, and most of Europe are at a level 3 travel health notice right now. South Korea is in a sustained ongoing community transmission as a level 3 health notice. The change beforehand, it was previously just Japan, was a level 2 travel health notice. Now level 2 is for the whole globe. And to get more information on what that means, you can go to the CDC website. But it wasn't yesterday, if we'd done this press conference at this time, the level 2 was just Japan, and now it's the entire globe. So it has changed. Erie County response activities, as you see, we've got many of our representatives here because we have been actively engaged in this for some time now. Planning and preparation, a voluntary precautionary quarantine and a mandatory quarantine. We'll go a little bit more into that. Community outreach and education. We've been out in the community talking about this, including an event that we held at the Moot Center just a couple nights ago. Public lab testing capability. We'll talk a little bit more about that. We are coordinating with other county agencies. We're coordinating with state and federal partners. When I say other county agencies, I'm talking about other counties in New York State and elsewhere. I actually was on the phone yesterday with counties executives from Houston, or from, Houston area, Harris, Texas, as well as across New York and Pennsylvania and Ohio. So it is not limited to the work that we're doing. It's just locally. Now, the voluntary and mandatory quarantine. There are 62 persons that are currently in quarantine. 60 were in voluntary quarantine. 2 were mandatory quarantine. 136 people have completed quarantine. So just because you're in quarantine doesn't mean that you are going to be ill. 136 people have actually completed the quarantine process as of approximately an hour ago. And there are 62 people in quarantine as we speak. Public health lab testing capability. As we spoke a couple days ago, the Erie County Public Health Lab now has the ability to test for coronavirus, COVID-19, as approved by the CDC, and test kits were provided by the CDC to our lab. In total, 17 county residents have been tested by all the labs, 1 the CDC, 9 New York State, 7 Erie County, and all of those tests have come back negative. 12 non-county residents have been tested here in our lab. We are aware, of course, that 1 was a positive, and that was Monroe County, and 11 others have been negative. The lab is currently testing 9 county residents and 11 non-county residents, and we hope to have some of those results today. Others might not be available until tomorrow based on just the timeliness of when the test was begun. So we are testing as we speak. There's actually 20 tests of individuals that are going on as we speak, 9 from Erie County, 11 from non-county residents. And we say non-county residents, we're talking about individuals that may reside in other Western New York counties. As you saw, we tested in Monroe County, and that one came back positive. So I don't know the locations of all of those, but we can tell you that there are currently 20 tests ongoing. So of all the tests we performed so far, only 1 came back positive, and that was the one from Monroe County. Of course, we're talking about other things when we talk about response strategies, which is to maintain dual and simultaneous strategies, including preventing the community spread. We don't have a confirmed case, but as you may have, if you were at the press conference I was at earlier with the mayor, we are going under the assumption that there are people in our community who have it. If it's in Monroe County, if it's in Dutchess County now, if it's in Ulster County, a couple days ago we talked about how it wasn't really in the Great Lakes area. We know there's cases now in Cleveland. We believe, in all likelihood, that there is a case here now. So as a result, we want to do all that we can to prevent the community spread of whatever that case may be. And then, of course, implementing non-pharmaceutical interventions, because there is no vaccine for COVID-19. I'll let the doc talk a little bit about this.
Sure. So the strategy for non-pharmaceutical interventions is to hopefully delay the onset of our epidemic. And then when it does begin, hopefully we will have, instead of a curve that you see under the purple line where we have a large spike, we have a huge increase, a huge burden of cases, it may be beyond our healthcare capacities, ability to care for everybody who requires an ICU bed or ventilation or ECMO. Instead, you know, we're hoping we'll get to the curve with under the slash lines, where it's a much lower peak. The duration is a little bit longer. However, we're always hopefully stay below where we would reach the capacity to care for those people who are very, very ill and overall have a lower number of positive cases.
So why don't you continue with our non-pharmaceutical intervention?
Right. So, again, since we don't have a vaccine to prevent this and we do not have any antivirals to treat it, we have to rely on non-pharmaceutical interventions. And so, again, the goal of this is to reduce their societal impact of this pandemic. And, you know, we've done this before. We planned for this before for, like, pandemic influenza. And so we have these plans in place for pandemic influenza. And we've been, you know, everybody in public health, including CDC, including us here in Erie County, have modified these pandemic influenza plans and to fit our COVID-19 response. Again, we want to slow down the transmission of virus in our community and keep our overall numbers low. So there are things that we can do on a personal level, and right now, since it's a very low-risk situation, there are things that we would do to protect ourselves against the flu. So wash our hands as much as we can with soap and water, and then we have community interventions and then environmental interventions, keeping it clean. So, our personal protective measures is against somebody is sick, stay away from them. And if you're sick, don't go to work. If your kids are sick, don't send them to the school. So, again, increase social distancing. Make sure you have good respiratory etiquette. So, again, if you sneeze or cough, sneeze into your arm or sneeze into a tissue and discard the tissue and wash your hands. Make sure you have good hand hygiene. Again, wash your hands with good water and running water and soap or alcohol-based hand sanitizers if you don't have that. And there are things that, you know, we can do, when we have, want to be seen by a healthcare provider. You know, we, many times when we have a respiratory infection, you know, we can do okay at home. So you want to call your healthcare provider first to see if you need to come in, because it's really not fair to everybody else if you come in to a healthcare provider's waiting room and you have some type of contagious viral illness and you make everybody sick in the waiting room. So, again, you want to make sure that we stay home and don't infect other people. And then we have other more enhanced personal protective measures when we have a pandemic. So, you know, we're going to get to a place where we have so many people that have been infected, so many people as exposed. Like, as a health department, we're not going to be able to monitor that. So we're going to ask the community then when they're sick or they've been exposed to voluntarily quarantine themselves without us having to monitor them or enforce that. Also, using face masks. And that's for people that are sick. For people who are well, they just use like a regular, like, you know, surgeon mask or procedure mask. That's not going to protect you. What you want to do with people who are sick, you want them to put on face masks so they won't cough or sneeze on you, or they won't, you know, have some little bit of, you know, spit when they talk to you. So, again, this is for sick people, not well people. It won't help well people. So, and then on a community level, we want to have enhanced social distancing. So, again, and this is a strategy to decrease viral transmission, and because we're going to decrease, high impact, you know, high volume social interactions. So we want to decrease face-to-face contacts. And so there are, you know, multiple measures to keep people over 6 feet apart and especially separate six people as much as we can, make sure that they are sent home. And so from, a community standpoint, do you want to take what our new recommendation are?
This is the recommendation from the Department of Health, Department of Emergency Services in Erie County. Based on CDC guidelines, we strongly recommend canceling all events with 250 or more people in attendance. We'll talk about some of those events that have already been canceled. We also recommend that people seriously consider avoiding attending any event or location with 50 or more, especially if it involves individuals from outside Erie County. And we strongly recommend that all people over the age of 60 and those with chronic medical conditions do not attend such events. And we have St. Patrick's weekend coming up, and we're also including in that bars and parties. There may not be a parade, but there's going to be lots of places where you might find 100 people in there. You don't know what they have. A lot of people are going to have a good time, but your good time could infect you. Depending on your health condition, you might get through it okay, but we all love our moms and dads and our grandparents, and if we went home and infected grandma and killed her, that's a bad thing. Doc said something very interesting a few days ago, and it got the attention of a group that we were in. People said, it'd be very disappointing if we had to cancel the event. It'd be very disappointing if you died, if you infected someone else and they died because of it, because you had to go out and go to that party, and then you came down with COVID-19, and maybe you got through it okay, but maybe you went home and saw your grandmother infected grandma, and grandma died because of it. It has a tremendous impact on those that are of older age. And so we want people to understand these are the recommendations, and the length that we are implementing for right now is the next 2 weeks, reevaluated as needed. Now, here are the events that have been canceled. Many of these that I've been involved in with others from third parties in the last few days. As you all know, both St. Patrick's Day parades are canceled. The Valley Parade on Saturday and the Irish American Association Parade on Sunday. The home show at the Buffalo Niagara Convention Center has been canceled. New York State USA Hockey Championships in Amherst have been canceled, as well as the USA Hockey Championships in general. The Niagara Cup 2020 Gymnastics Championships, which were scheduled to be held at Canisius College this weekend, have been canceled. The Star Swimming event, which was bringing in individuals from across upstate New York and southern Ontario at SUNY Erie, has been canceled. The YMCA swimming event at SUNY Erie has been canceled. We all hear about other sports leagues. The NBA and NHL have suspended their league, as well as other ones, and we're hearing now the NCAA, of course, ruled that they will play the games for the tournaments, but no attendees, and now some teams are just announcing that they're not going to play. So there are many events that have already been canceled in our community, and we want people to seriously consider, during this situation, going to a place where there are lots of folks. You could put yourself at risk, and even if you get through it okay, there's a very good chance you can infect someone else, because the infection rate, as the doc noted, is for every person who's infected, they infect 2.2 people. You could infect somebody that you care deeply about, causing them serious harm and or death. And finally, environmental non-pharmaceutical interventions. This is what we're doing very, very vigorously in county government, which is cleaning tables, cleaning doorknobs, cleaning keyboards, cleaning anywhere where the public is going, cabinets and countertops. And as we see, we also have recommendations that are out there from the CDC for all different types of workplaces, childcare agencies. We have toys on there. Well, we do have toys in some of our county departments, especially that deal with children. We have little play areas, and those have to be cleaned multiple times a day. As we all know, kids are germ vectors. There's no doubt about that. They're germ repositories. And while the children might get through this okay, which seems to be happening, if they go home and they infect a family member, they could seriously cause ill to their family member. So the environmental MPIs, you heard a lot about this. I think everyone's taking this seriously by what you see in stores, which is a sellout of all types of disinfectants, a sellout of other goods. We want people to act appropriately, not panic. We received reports earlier today that while hospital ERs were having normal visitation, and we don't think anyone should ever go to an ER unless it's necessary or recommended by a doctor, we did hear that doctor visits, people just walking in, are much higher, urgent care numbers are much higher, and that is probably not the place you want to go. If you are healthy but you think you're sick, you don't want to go to a place where there could be people who are sick and then you infect yourself. So as we showed earlier, if you are feeling ill, you should contact your doctor first. Talk to your doctor, let them know what your symptoms are, and let them make a decision on what is the most appropriate thing for you. Don't just go to the ER. Don't just go to urgent care. Don't just show up at your doctor's office. Call them first. And in the meantime, do your best to ensure that you're cleaning your household and your workspaces so that they are safe from others. Doc?
Sure. So the question is, where are we going to push the button? Because in the past, we've really had more of a reactive approach. So when we wait till our numbers of influenza get really, really high and then schools think about closing and, you know, we think about shutting things down. But now we have the opportunity. We know that we're going to have a huge spike in respiratory infections from COVID-19. So now we have time to plan. So right now that we don't have any cases in Erie County, we're in our non-pharmaceutical intervention planning phase. And so we're investigating cases, we're looking for them, and trying to recognize cases. And we're starting to implement like the low level non-pharmaceutical interventions like washing your hands and keeping things clean. And then we are gonna have our first case. And then that's when we really think about stepping it up with our non-pharmaceutical interventions. And then we're starting to start to see a pretty steep increase. And before we get to that steep slope, right before then, that's when we want to push the button and initiate our aggressive non-pharmaceutical interventions. And hopefully we'll be able to keep those up at a very high level and have everybody in the community work together. And until we get through this epidemic, this outbreak, and then we'll be able to go back to business as usual. And so we have a lot of great resources on our Erie County Health Department website. We have a website devoted just to COVID-19, and we put all the most current information up there. And also the New York State Health Department and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention have great information, and we have links to them on our website. I mean, the problem is that this is a scary time. I mean, this is a new virus. None of us have lived through a pandemic before. The last one was over 100 years ago. And it's a new virus. We're learning new things all the time about it. And it's scary because there's a lot of missing information. And in these circumstances, many times people will make things up and spread false rumors and, post it on YouTube or on Facebook or on a blog or something like that. And, people are hungry for information. They'll believe it. And so it's really important that we stick to the facts and we ensure that our audiences, that our community goes to these websites and with good factual information, because we don't want people making bad choices based on bad information. Also, Erie County has a help phone line, is 858-2929. And so again, the healthcare providers are working really hard trying to take care of sick people. If you have questions, if your viewers have questions, they should go to one of these websites or they can call our helpline and ask for information. Please do not call our helpline and say, "I want help getting a test." That is something that you talk to your healthcare provider. That is a test that is primarily ordered by the healthcare provider, and they may collect the specimen. They may need us to help collect the specimen, but we need information. We need to be contacted by a healthcare provider who wants to order the test, and then we work and they collect information about the individual case to see if it meets the New York State Health Department criteria for COVID-19 testing, and then we work with them, if that's true, to make sure the person is in quarantine for 14 days and also make sure that the appropriate specimens are collected with appropriate personal protective equipment and gets to our laboratory in time to be run. So our whole community is actually expanding capacity to test. So right now we have capacity at the Erie County Health Department. We have heard that Kaleida Health, Roswell Park, And also ECMC, those labs are all going to have testing capacity hopefully within the next week or so. So our community is really going to be able to rev up testing and identify people who have COVID-19, and hopefully we'll all be able to work together to make sure those people are in isolation and make sure people have exposed to them are in quarantine, and do what we can on a community level, on a personal level, and on an environmental level to institute these non-pharmaceutical interventions to keep our numbers low, to keep the numbers below our healthcare's capacity, so we'll be able to take care of all the people that are really, really sick.
Thank you, Doc. With that, I'd like to bring up to the podium our Commissioner of Homeland Security Emergency Services, Dan Neverett, just to talk a little bit about what they've been dealing with behind the scenes. As you know, we often are at the Emergency Operations Center if we have a state of emergency. Well, we are not in a state of emergency in Erie County right yet, and we're not at the Emergency Operations Center because we don't have an emergency yet. We are addressing the issue to avoid community spread, but that does not mean that Homeland Security Emergency Services hasn't been working. So, Commissioner?
Thanks, Bob. Yeah, just wanted to give a quick update. For several weeks now, we've had up and running what we refer to as a virtual emergency operations center. And we've talked in the past that our disasters that we have a system in place. It's a web-based system. It's called Disaster Land. The New York State system is known as New York Response. So that allows us to be able to, whether it's from home, from this room right here, or even in an emergency operations center if we had a mass gathering of individuals, to be able to mitigate some of these issues, put things through to the state, and contact all of our partners. So right now that's in a virtual state, but I did want everybody to know that we've also worked on command structures. We've worked on policies and procedures with regard to that. Policy groups, which you see a good portion of the policy group here, where you sit down on a regular basis and have discussions with regards to whether or not we're going to have a state of emergency, what some of the decisions are that need to be made with regards to some of the mass gathering events. Very robust conversation that took place this morning, and I think you saw the end result that the parade had been canceled by that. We wanted the individuals to make that decision on their own, and they arrived at the right decision. We are in close communication, as we always are, whether it's 7 feet of snow or, in this particular case, with all of our external partners. That includes hospitals. That includes elected officials. There was a briefing held for all elected officials on Saturday out at the Emergency Operations Center, just to update them on this exact same presentation that you saw right here. We have conference calls that are going to be taking place almost on a daily basis. We have one scheduled for this afternoon. The key here is for all of our external partners and even internal partners to be kept on the same page. We get asked a lot of times, what's the key to emergency management, incident management? And we come back to the same things. It's communications, collaboration, and cooperation. So we need to make sure that we're all on the same page, because as the doc more than effectively pointed out, the fact there are people out there that are putting out tremendous volumes of misinformation. And we need to make sure that we're all talking the same language, and that we're pushing that exact same information. So what we're also doing is we're talking to the state about available supplies. We have additional supplies on our own. But now we're just getting to that point where we need to focus on the jobs at hand, mass gatherings, and pushing that message, that important message, out to everybody to make sure that we all, and by we mean everybody within Erie County and everybody within your viewership or your readership, understands that this is something that we all have to work on together. So emergency services, the Erie County Sheriff's Office, we, by the way, have within our subdivision within the Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Services and the Health Department, that's public health emergency preparedness. It's not something that just gets whipped up when we have events similar to this. They're constantly working on the relationships with the hospitals. They're constantly working on the relationships that we have with all of our communities, including potential points of dispensing and all those things. You've seen evidence of that on a regular basis when it comes to the HEPA pods. So we all work very, very closely, partners in the county, the state, the feds, and yes, the towns and the villages. So that, in a nutshell, is just a few of the things that we've been doing with emergency services over the last probably 2.5 to 3 weeks, very, very accurately.
Thank you, Commissioner. As was noted, we want people to understand we're providing factual, accurate information. In the last 24 hours, at least, our phone lines have been receiving calls from individuals demanding they be tested. We don't make that determination. You have to go through your doctor, and then protocols are put in place to determine if it is appropriate for you to be tested. We've had people calling us saying, I've heard rumors, and it's been confirmed that there are multiple people here that have cases of COVID-19, and the answer is there are zero individuals that we've tested, that the state's tested. Anyone that we're aware of that's been tested that lives in Erie County, or for that matter, Niagara, Chautauqua, Cattaraugus, Orleans, Genesee, Wyoming, that has it. We do know now there's now one in Monroe, and we're going under the assumption, based on the spread that we've seen across the country, that there are individuals in this community that have it. We know that there's individuals in Southern Ontario and the Toronto area that have it. So we're doing everything possible to ensure that we're adequately prepared when we do identify that case number one, but to ensure that when the cases are identified, we're keeping the total amount low, and we're doing the best that we can to ensure that the individuals who need care get care, that our ERs are not flooded with individuals who shouldn't be there, that urgent cares are not flooded with individuals that shouldn't be there. If you're feeling not so good, contact your doctor. And if you are sick, don't go into work. We've continued our conversations with others. We had a very fruitful conversation with school superintendents earlier today. We will continue those conversations. We're also taking guidance from New York State Education Department with regards to schools. We are listening to the guidance from New York State as well as the CDC. But we want people to understand that we got a great team here of professionals in the Department of Health, Department of Emergency Services, all the departments, Sheriff's Office. We've been through emergencies before, maybe not one exactly like this, but we've got a great team. We work hand in hand together, and it shows because of the response we've had in the past. And if we do that again, is the public doing that, ensuring that we follow the appropriate protocols, don't panic, understand that we'll get through this, we'll get through it all together. And that's what I'm hoping will happen in the long run. With that, I'll entertain some questions. Michael.
The issue in China, issue in Italy, is people are quarantined and they have no food. So they either have, I don't know, whatever the Chinese equivalent of Grubhub delivering meals, or in Italy, they go out to grocery stores. Are you going to have provisions for getting food to people so that they don't go to the grocery stores when they're in quarantine?
Well, what we're trying to do is not become like New Rochelle, New York. But what you see in New Rochelle is the response from New York State, which is bringing in the National Guard to help distribute food and the like. So I can't make a comparison to Italy or China, what they're doing there, and I certainly would not want to do that. China is a whole different type of country and what they can do and order instantaneously. They basically build a hospital in 3 days. Italy, totally different situation as well. But I think you look at New Rochelle and see that's the kind of action that if it got to that point here, you might see here as well. Containment zones, National Guard coming in, working with the state, working with our federal partners. Our goal is to ensure we don't get to that point. Nothing against my friends in Westchester County, but we don't want to be like New Rochelle is today. We want to avoid that situation. Edison?
That we're testing here in Erie County, we're operating under the presumption that one of them is going to be positive.
No. No. We're assuming there's someone in this community that has it. We don't know, and we're not operating under the presumption that any of those are positive. We're testing them to confirm they are not.
And in those cases that are being tested, do we know whether they were spread, community spread, travel?
I can't go into them, and I don't know personally.
Can I just check that number? Across the street, Doc, I thought you said that there were 10 Erie County residents being tested today, but now we're saying the number is 9.
Right. I mean, I have, a little bit more updated information.
Okay, and then further, the other number I was going to check was across the street. You indicated 19 Erie County residents have already been tested, but now we're seeing the number 17. I just want to confirm those numbers.
Right, so from our Erie County Public Health Lab, we've had 9 tested so far, and 10 are pending today, and so that was kind of new late this morning. And then from CDC, those are Erie County residents. CDC also tested 1 resident, and Wadsworth tested 9 residents. And then from other counties, there were 11 other county residents tested so far, and then 11 are pending today. So we I just received that before they started running the tests.
There was another number I hoped you could clarify again from across the street.
Sure.
I thought I heard at one point you said that you had the capacity to test up to 450 per day, and then another time I thought...
No. I said right now we could do... Right, so sorry for the clarification. So right now we're doing 1 run a day, and that's meeting our demand, and that's about 21, tested, 20 some odd tests a day. And we can ramp that up to a total of about 120 tests per day. Right now we have enough reagent to run about 450 tests. We have more reagent on order, but right now we could run up to 450 tests total. Not at the same time.
And that's why we're saying to folks, not everybody's going to get a test. And if you come and call to our public health lab, we have the ability to perform, and that is including, well, probably a little less than that now because we're running tests, but it was 450 as of this morning, and now we're talking about some other tests that are being performed. So we're really talking about 425 or so test kits that are available to do these protocols. We've requested more. We've been told we're going to get more. We were one of the first public health labs in this community to get it, in our community, New York State. As of right now, I still believe there's only 3 labs that are testing: Wadsworth, New York City, and Erie. Northwell, I think, is going online as soon, but everyone's been talking about go to Roswell. Roswell can't test right now. They don't have capability of testing. They announced they hope to have capability of testing, but people we know have been contacting Roswell saying, we want to be tested, and they can't even test at this moment. So we want people to understand there's not tens of thousands of tests that can be performed. We received an initial batch, and the individuals that are tested are based on the protocols, such as where did you visit? Were you with someone who visited an area outside? Were you with someone who has tested positive? Were you in New Rochelle? So, and what are your symptoms?
Mark, this weekend is traditionally these bars and restaurants have a hard time staying in their regular capacity. And not to mention church fish fries and stuff like that. Who's going to be doing the enforcement of the bars and restaurants going on the honor system?
I'm not going to them. And I would not recommend other people at this point until we feel that it's safe. The governor issued an order with regards to larger events, no more than 500, and they want to reduce that even more. We are saying we are strongly recommending not having any events over 250, and we recommend that you should not be in a place with more than 50. But we know there's going to be lots of places. We do not have the capability of stopping them, short of declaring a state of emergency and martial law, which we're not going to do. But people need to be smart. People need to be smart. You're putting yourself at risk. You're putting your family member at risk. What? So you can go out and party? And there's a lot of people who are saying it's a hoax. Well, probably less people saying it today than there were yesterday after the president's speech. But it's not a hoax. Yes?
Like I said, you mentioned it already. You touched upon it in terms of the education perspective. Obviously, as these numbers surge, there's a couple of events on the horizon, graduations, proms, spring sports schedule. Is this going to be a determination district by district? Is it going to have to be a state mandate in terms of how these events are canceled?
With regards to the schools at this point, we are telling the school districts to confirm the directives and guidance from the state education department. And as we noted, the recommendations that we have are for the next 2 weeks. It's possible that the virus goes dramatically down. I don't think that's going to happen. It's possible. But I think what we're going to see is we're going to see that continued upward climb of new cases and being continually spread across the country. So we're making recommendations now based on, number one, we don't have a confirmed case in Erie County. So we're assuming that there's someone probably here. And number two, looking at what's happened elsewhere, what are the type of events that you should not attend? We could be changing that 3 days from now. If all of a sudden we do tests and every single one of the tests came back positive, and then we saw that none of them are related to each other, then we'd be very worried about community spread. And then we'd change the parameters of our suggestions.
Mark,
Sandra.
I also have questions about how exactly samples are being gathered for folks. So let's say you think you could have been exposed to the virus, you call your doctor. Are people actually being expected to go to their doctor's office, or are they, if the doctor thinks that they might have a real case, are samples being gathered where they are, or are they being directed to go somewhere? And I'm also interested to get more specifics on how exactly the samples are being taken, from where are they being taken, like what is the process involved with that?
Sure. So with the process for somebody to get tested is they would have to consult with a healthcare provider, so it would be an order from a healthcare provider, and or else it would be somebody that we're following in quarantine who develops symptoms, and then they may become eligible for testing. And so for the former, if somebody consults with their healthcare provider, they could do it over the phone. You just need to have some information, historical information about travel or possible exposure, and then the type of symptoms. And then the healthcare provider would call our epidemiology office and consult with one of our epidemiologists. And then if they meet the New York State criteria, we would recommend testing. And so there are different strategies to collect the specimens, and the specimens are nasal pharyngeal, so in the nostril, and then oral pharyngeal in the back of the throat. So there are two places that are sampled. Also, if somebody's in a hospital and they have a productive cough and they're able to provide some sputum, then we are also able to test that. So there can be different strategies of collecting those specimens. If a person is at, say, a hospital or an urgent care center, emergency department, and they have the capacity to collect those specimens, they can collect them and get them to us. Or we can, if it's an individual, we could either send a nurse out to collect the specimens, or we could have that individual come to our health department clinic site, and then a nurse can collect the specimens there. So there are different strategies.
Going back to testing.
Michael, you had a question first, then I'll come to you.
Mark, is there a threshold for a state of emergency?
That would be determined based on consultation with the policy group, the state, our hospitals. It's a little easier probably to determine a state of emergency when you have a blizzard, but it's the same protocols that we hear from our Department of Public Works, the Sheriff's Office, Emergency Services, Highway Superintendents, that snow's falling at a rate of 3.5 inches an hour and you can't see, looks pretty bad. So we utilize the same process, we might just rely on different individuals at that point.
And for people who aren't aware, what would a state of emergency allow the county to do in this situation?
Well, there are many powers that come with that, such as closing locations. Actually, we talk about driving bans. You cannot have a driving ban unless you have a state of emergency. Well, you could have a ban on being out in public. There are many, many powers that come with the state of emergency that are appropriate for the circumstances. Now, they're not infinite, and they're not forever. They're only for a temporary time period. But there are many powers that would be generated for this office, for health, for emergency services, for the sheriffs. And I think if you remember to the storm back in 2014 when the National Guard was here and there was a driving ban, and there they were with the M16s, and people were saying, hey, I wanted to pick up the pizza. You're going to get arrested if you try to enter this location. Why? Because we had a driving ban and orders to arrest individuals and charge them with a misdemeanor if they violated the driving ban in certain locations. So there's all kinds of things that could be done in a state of emergency that we do not normally have. It also gives us additional powers with regards to purchasing. So beforehand, if I want to enter into a contract to purchase, let's say, a whole new ton, a gross of masks, normally I'd have to bid it out, get the approval from the legislature. In a state of emergency, I can make a decision like that, purchase it, have our purchasing office do that, and then after the state emergency is over with, we go back to our standard protocols.
Going back to testing, I mean, Dr. Burstein, you said when Kaleida, Roswell, ECMC labs get that testing approach, what is that number 450 going to go to?
I'm not sure what the other hospital's capacity is, so you would have to ask them.
So, but it would exponentially increase? I mean, is this a good thing, a bad thing?
Yeah, we want to have more capacity to do more testing, so we'll be able to meet the demand.
What are your recommendations for those going to churches this weekend, gyms, places like that may have more than 50 people, 250 people, things like that?
Stay at home.
David?
On the questions regarding quarantine, voluntary or involuntary.
So, I'm sorry, can I just, there are other opportunities. I'm not saying don't exercise or don't pray. So we just have to think about alternative strategies because all those things are important. So we just have to think, this is a different situation right now. So how can we do this and still comply with social distancing?
Regarding quarantine and more so voluntary, Dr. Burstein, because involuntary speaks for itself. But I'm wondering, under those circumstances, and you tell someone, please stay home. The stay home means staying in your house, too. And the reason I ask is that when all this started, if you told somebody you need to stay in your house a couple of weeks, it was pretty cold out to get anyone would find it. I might have looked forward to it. But as we progress here into warmer weather, it's sunny and it's 60, it's going to be harder for people to resist the temptation, even if they've agreed to stay home.
People who are under quarantine not exposing themselves to others. So in the cold weather when people aren't running around outside, that would be staying in your room. You're right, in the warm weather, if they're able to go outside and in a place where there's nobody else, that, you know, that's okay.
Yeah.
But again, it's just, remember, the goal is to remove that person from contact with other people. And so if you can, you know, you can do that in your home, in your own room, and, you know, hopefully you have access to your own toilet. And then if you have, ability, you live in a place where you have access to, a yard or something where there's nobody else around, you can go there. We just don't want you exposing yourself to other people.
Two more questions, Mark. What are you doing in these buildings, in the RAP building and in the Old County Hall, with so many people coming in and out daily and so many people working there?
A lot. Well, first off, we actually have a pretty vigorous cleaning mechanism anyway, because we have the public that comes in on a daily basis, and we are aware that the public does come in with germs and flu and so forth. But there's more effort that's being made, especially in public-facing locations. Earlier this week, I had a meeting with members of the other independently elected officials and the chairman of the legislature. And for example, Clerk Kern said, well, they had new hospital-grade chairs, but they were asking us, can we clean those down at the end of every night? And the answer is yes. So there is vigorous efforts to be made during the day and especially after the work hours to clean countertops, to clean locations where individuals are. Individual workstations where people only work them themselves, we're reminding them, clean them in the morning, clean it yourself. But if no one else is using it, you shouldn't have to worry about getting disinfectant on your keyboard and things like that. But in the areas where the public is entering, it is being cleaned multiple times a day, and there's a vigorous cleaning that we do after the work hours to ensure that it's virus-free as best as anyone can make it the next day.
The Capitol closed to visitors. The state's considering closing to visitors. Is the county considering closing to visitors?
The Capitol is a different location than us. I may go there and lobby on behalf of Erie County, but I still think the Capitol is going to be open for the Senate and the Assembly. But it's not where you go to renew your license. It's not where you go if you have an issue with regards to Child Protective Services. So there's certain things that we just can't close. We have continuity of operation plans, and I've requested every one of the departments to go through their continuity of operation plans once again to confirm what we had to do if we had to close, because there's certain things we still must do. We still must go out there and check on at-risk children. We still have services that the public have to come in on. You cannot get a new license unless you come in and go through the application process, have your picture taken and the like. So there's certain things that we cannot close. And when I heard the governor say that earlier about the Capitol, I don't believe he was talking about shutting down state government to the public. I think he was talking about the Capitol building itself, which gets a lot of tourists. When I've been there, and I've been there a few times this year, there's a lot of tourists going around. Maybe you don't want the tourists going around the Capitol building. And we wouldn't necessarily want tourists walking around the RATH building, but generally tourists don't walk around the RATH building. If they're in the RATH building, they're here for business.
If we get to the point, Mark, where we are kind of mass canceling, closing school districts, daycares, how is the county ready to help parents who are going to be looking for someone to watch their children while they're at work?
Well, we do not have daycare services. It's not like the county provides daycare services. We support daycare services through our Department of Social Services. We provide funding for daycare services. We also provide direct funding for assistance for families so they can pay for daycare. The county does not have daycare facilities, if that's what you're asking about, Chris. We would work with our partners in the daycare field to ensure that as many of those are kept open as possible. But there would be, if it became a true pandemic in this region, I think we'd be seeing a lot of what's going on elsewhere, which is people are being said, you got to stay home. We don't want to get to that point. That's why we're implementing the things that we are today to avoid community spread. But you're thinking about stuff that is in our continuity of operations plan. And I don't know if any of the other representatives want to speak about how they're thinking about things that we hope we never have to enter into, but we have those in the plans for just that reason. But right now, it's a matter of preventing the spread of this across our community to the point we get that. If we get there, then it is something we'd have to address at that point. But I don't also want to enter into a hypothetical.
I understand that, but I'm kind of asking on behalf of maybe a single mom who lives, you know, somewhere, who is thinking about, my goodness, mm-hmm. what am I going to do? I have to go and I have to work this job. If my two or three kids, they can't go to school, I have to go to work. And they're already thinking about, I don't know what I'm going to do.
It's a significant concern. I believe it's also one of the reasons why the president and the governor have talked about independent aid packages to help individuals if they have to take off because of self-quarantine or they have their child is quarantined. That is why you're seeing federal and state representatives talk about that as a possible assistance for families that otherwise could lose a home, would potentially not be able to pay the rent and then be evicted. None of us want to see that in a situation. The governor has extreme powers in that situation to prevent some of that. If it was a state of emergency, there's certain actions that we could take here, not to the same extent as the governor. We just hope we don't get to that point. One more question, Sandy.
You're already recommending that not more than 250 people gather, but all of the public schools are still open. That's a lot of kids, not only during class, but also after school activities, sporting events. Are you actually making some specific recommendations?
We've had multiple conversations with them, including a very long conference call earlier today. I believe they're going to be announcing fairly soon some internal things like no mass band when they go to the band and everyone sits in the audience and things like that. They understand the concern. We're concerned. I also believe it's important that they take guidance from the State Education Department. We are different than right now what you're seeing in Rochelle, New Rochelle. If it got to a point where we had an area that had a concern and an outbreak, then you would see schools that were closed. I believe the governor has announced if there is a patient that is tested positive for COVID-19, that's a student or a teacher or an employee at a school, that school would immediately close for 24 hours until they could determine further action that needs to be taken. So we are one part working with others to ensure that things are being done properly. We also want to ensure that we're working with our partners in state government. Erie County, as a government, does not have a huge role in the schools and the administration of schools. The state does. And so we think that's important.
Roswell Park wanted you to say something.
Oh, Roswell Park wants me to say something. Watching the executive's briefing.
Just don't go to Roswell.
Don't go to Roswell, as I said. Roswell Park is not collecting samples from people for COVID-19. Samples collected elsewhere will be sent to our labs. So as they say, watch the executive briefings and wanted to clarify that Roswell Park is not collecting samples from people for COVID-19. Samples collected elsewhere will be sent to our labs. So right now, Roswell Park can't do anything. They're not collecting samples, and they don't even have the ability to do the testing. With that, everyone, thank you.
Examples.